Hello, people of the internet, my name is Johnny, and welcome back to yet another reaction to Game Theory. Is it just me, or have we been getting a lot of Game Theory FNAF episodes recently? Which is strange, considering the franchise is kinda in a weird place. FNAF AR isn't doing any lore, we've had one game from Ska, but that didn't really have any lore. Security Breach doesn't come out till later this year. We're in kind of a dead zone right now, and yet we're still getting consistently game theories. But most interestingly of all is that these game theories aren't your typical game theories. It seems like MatPat is trying to go for a different style of game theories when it comes to FNAF, at least for right now, while we're kind of, again, in this dead zone, where in one video, he gives us basically three separate mini theories that we can speculate on. And I think it's important to know that these are kind of like mini theories. I don't think he legitimately is trying to fully flesh all these things out. That's why they're condensed into like three mini theories in one episode. I could be wrong, I don't know. But funny story about this video, this dropped maybe like 2 minutes after Scott made his post about the drama. So that sure was perfect timing. And speaking of timing, let's not waste any more of it. So without further ado, this is Game Theory FNAF Return to the Pit. I'm guessing we're gonna be talking about the books. I guess we're going back to Into the Pit. I guess we're gonna hop back into the pit, and now let's hop into this video. Starting off with the purple guy. FNAF 3 again.
You stupid ghost, thought you could get revenge on me? Do you know who I am? I'm William Afton. I always come back.
Is that his new voice for the movie?
I'm about to end this man's whole career.
It's not wrong. How depressing is that? You die from like a singular little water drop
to Game Theory. The wet Springlock suit clamped down on your subscription feeds. And oh my gosh,
subscribe!
Guys, finally, after all that waiting, after being patient for so long, after all the delays, it has finally arrived. It is here.
Oh, is he gonna make a Furious Rage joke?
Just released, where we finally get to go up against Vanny the Killer Bunny.
Yeah.
Here it is, Security Breach. Furries. Rage.
No Furies.
Didn't know it had a subtitle.
No Furies.
It's about an onslaught of angry furries on the attack.
No.
Oh, wait, sorry. Misread that title. It's a Fury. Furies Rage. Very important distinction there. Well, anyway, let's fire this puppy up.
Let's see if they're ready for Freddy.
The music box. I don't care what you say. Also, the game's good.
What I expected on multiple fronts. A game-long apology for all the delays with the real security breach.
Wait, is he upset?
They're gonna kill me. They're gonna kill me when they find out that I have to delay the game again. What am I gonna do?
You can tell that Scott's feeling a little guilty these days, huh? Also,
yeah.
Apparently he sleeps in a fairy tale bed. Learned a lot about you with this one, Scott. Anyway, just because the official game is still TBD doesn't mean that there's any less
I
to
hope
theorize
Matt's not about. Legitimately
we've
upset.
We've got secret bosses,
I
and
hope.
We've got
hope,
a lot
I,
of
I
pent-up theories
you know,
behind the floodgates
chill
just
about
waiting
it.
To pour out. So today, I'm doing another roundup of short FNAF theories, some looking back to the past, some looking ahead towards the future, and
ooh,
some
that's
that,
that
are
new
so
story.
Out there that, well,
called.
You're gonna see when we get there. So
someone's
open your
lucky
minds,
day.
Your hearts, and your hollow animatronic chest cavities reserved for the bodies of dead children, because I'm shoving theories in everywhere. Theory number one, we definitely play as Michael Afton in FNAF 3. In the newest Fazbear Fight,
I feel like we knew this,
Angel,
but pop off King.
Of May, we as always have our three main horror novellas. The first is the title feature Gumdrop Angel, a tragic tale about a girl who transforms into a giant gummy bear pinata thing that gets eaten alive by a swarm of saliva mouth kids at a Freddy's
Yo,
birthday party.
My
talk about your hygiene concerns.
My favorite FNAF
a heck of
lore.
A lot scarier reading it in the aftermath of a global pandemic, but as you might imagine, not a whole lot of lore to be found in a story about a sentient gummy
I was
bear.
Just kidding,
our second
of course.
Story, Sergio's Lucky Day, is
that's
all
it.
About Balloon Boy, or should I say Lucky Boy, a doll who's wearing a propeller hat and holding both a balloon and a sign that says, I'm a lucky boy. In this story,
I'm a lucky boy, old boy.
Sergio finds the doll and ends up buying a lottery ticket because of its advice. The next day, Sergio finds that he won himself $600,000.
Yo, big W?
Lottery. That's great.
It's a story that's a bit confusing because the doll
big
does
dub?
Seem to offer good advice, encouraging Sergio Sergio to leave a job that he hates, leave a girlfriend that he hates, upgrade his life in small ways. All
good
things
advice.
That improve Sergio's existence.
Yo.
As a result, Sergio becomes obsessed with the doll, asking it for advice on everything, including how he can look good for his big high school reunion. Lucky Boy suddenly takes the chance to turn evil and tells him to remove his ears, scalp himself, cut off his eyelids, chisel his lips, trim his nose, and remove and reuse other body parts to become taller. As you might imagine, Sergio makes a big impression.
By the way,
reunion.
For people watching, I haven't read all the stories. This is the first time I'm hearing about what happens.
That this is going to end up being connected to the upcoming Book 9 story, The Puppet Carver, but we're just going to have to wait and see.
Well, funny
and
story about that. We know
that
about those
stories. This book wasn't
going
to deliver on any lore
video coming soon.
We get to our third story, What We Found, which is quite literally just a retelling of FNAF 3. Stop me if this one starts to sound familiar. A night security guard working at Fazbear Frights, a horror attraction themed around the murders
direct
and disappearances
name dropping.
Happening at
okay.
the Freddy Fazbear Pizzeria franchise, begins suffering from severe hallucinations the day the crew brings in a springtrap suit found hidden in the walls of a different building. Hudson, our night guard, winds up trapped in a pizza oven and gets roasted to death at the end of his shift. It is really sad and also a really obvious parallel to the events of FNAF 3.
Damn,
right? But here's the thing. It also really feels like it's meant to confirm for us that Michael Afton is who we play as in FNAF 3. If you remember back to a couple of years ago, I had a theory that Mike Afton is our player character in pretty much every game in the franchise. We see the name Mike on FNAF 1's paycheck. Yep. We see the name Mike again on the monitor and sister location.
Unit.
In fact, the player's guide for that game,
breach.
The Freddy Files, practically confirms that part of the theory. So that's Mike appearing in two games, but what about FNAF 2 and 3? The name Mike doesn't appear anywhere in either of them. Well, in FNAF 1, we know that Mike eventually gets fired for
Mike
tampering
is in the game
animatronics
files of FNAF 2,
odor,
if you didn't know.
Something that would happen if, you know, he was a rotting corpse walking around from restaurant to restaurant to free the souls of the dead kids trapped in the suits put there by his father. So isn't it a little coincidental that Fritz Smith, our protagonist from FNAF 2, gets fired for the exact same reason?
Yeah.
Tampering with the animatronics and odor. It's also why Michael would keep getting attacked. We know from
Damn,
sister location
so much
that
like
he
a
looks
throwback.
Just like his dear old daddy. And lastly, it's why Golden Freddy says it's me every time he appears. It's the brother's soul, crying child, trapped in the suit, recognizing and reaching out to his sibling, Mike. But then, what about FNAF 3? When I first presented the theory, I thoughtfully omitted FNAF 3. It made sense to me from a narrative angle, but in terms
Mad
of
Pat,
actual
you
physical
admit.
Evidence, there wasn't a whole lot to point to outside of the hallucinations. Since the phantom animatronic jump scares in FNAF 3 were moments pulled from both FNAF 1 and 2, it implies that the person seeing them must have been present in both those locations.
I guess it makes
so
sense.
That, yeah, bupkis. However, what we found may have just given us our missing piece. Our security guard Hudson in the
we
story has a very tragic
piece?
Existence. His dad took his own life at an early age, and his mother got remarried to an abusive man named Lewis. And this guy is awful. Like, he is real bad. Eventually, we learn that Hudson seems to have burned his house down, killing this violent man in the process, and then repressing those memories. Fast forwarding back to the present day, as he's tormented by Springtrap, he hears his dad's voice coming from the suit. That, along with a former abusive teacher named Mr. Atkin, or Mr. Adkin, depending on which page you're talking about. I'm looking at you, proofreaders, you got some splaining to do. Anyway, Hudson
so
kills
funny.
His violent father in a fire. A father whose voice comes out of Springtrap, along with another person associated with childhood trauma and with a name suspiciously close to Afton. The security guard himself then dies in a fire in a tightly contained pizza oven. To me, it sounds a heck of a lot like the journey of Mike, who would also be responsible for burning his spring-trapped serial killer father to death at the end of FNAF 3 before he himself meets a fiery end in FNAF 6, also trapped
so
inside
Mike
of a
So, Mike set
box.
Fire
it's
to
the potentially
the
confirmation
Fazbear
that I've
Frights.
Been waiting on for years.
Yeah.
Or not. Who knows? Speaking of FNAF 3, here's a small observation that didn't fit anywhere, but I wanted to call out. You know how we're pretty confident that Golden Freddy was possessed by two spirits, Crying Child and Cassidy, the vengeful spirit? Well, it seems like Scott may have been hinting at that since FNAF 3. I couldn't believe it
Scott,
either, but
you
take
cheeky
a look. Here's
fellow.
A photo of the bad ending from that game. Notice how the mask in the background, Golden Freddy, has two lights on in his eyes instead of just one like all the others? Each light would be representative of a spirit trapped in the suit. Shout out to Game Theorist subreddit user The Real Brofi for that one.
I might go back to that still.
Subject to Cassidy, theory number two,
that's
Cassidy died in the ball pit. Recently, it was confirmed by
Into
Scott Cawthon on
Reddit
that the Fazbear Frights book series will end at number 11. Random number, but the 12th mini book full of stories that
oh my god, what is that render?
Bonus. Gotta admit, it's a bit of a shame because this whole time I was hoping they would get 76 more out of this thing just so we could make a joke along the lines of, was that the right of 87?
Is that the
anyway,
right of 87?
We're in the endgame now, specifically with the story of Detective Larson and the Stitch Wraith, the overarching narrative that happens in the epilogue of each installment. And that's
oh my god,
nothing
look at
to sneeze at, my friends. Is that idiom acceptable after 2020? Anyway, it's a big deal since this is the story that's historically had the biggest lore reveals. Most notably, the hints that led us to believe that Golden Freddy had two souls trapped inside of him instead of just one. Mm-hmm. And with only three epilogues left before the end of the series, this story needs to have itself a really big payoff.
I wonder if number 12 is going to have
one. Heroes, they had just battled a 15-foot trash rabbit called the Afton Amalgamation. By the end, Larson got infected with the glitch trap virus, and Jake, the remaining spirit inside the Stitch Wraith, realized that he could use his, I don't know, his remnant powers to basically go into people's
the
memories
power
and
of
make
friendship
stronger in order to help them.
Yay.
Maybe he could pull a memory out, a good one, and make it bigger and brighter than the rest. If he could, he could ease the man's pain. It was almost like blowing up a balloon, only the balloon was a memory and the air was Jake's will. It's about on par with the level of insanity you'd expect from FNAF in the year of Lulbit 2021. And well, that's certainly an interesting story detail. Huh. What I instead want to focus on is Larson's half of the plot. The detective who's been trying to piece together all the mysteries around Fazbear Entertainment. Getting infected by the Afton virus has had some weird side effects on him. Specifically, it's allowed him to hop between the memories of a bunch of Afton's victims.
Ooh,
quote, he was getting glimpses of the past. They were memories, but not his own. These images belonged to others from different places and different times. So it feels like this is the literary device that's going to allow the books to explain the missing children's incident. Larson is going to get clues via this memory hopping to either see for himself or get the clues to investigate what happened to Susie, Gabriel, Fritz, Jeremy, Charlie, and Cassidy. But then things start to take an unexpected turn. One final quote. As his mind swept him from one visit to the past to another, he always saw the same thing in between. He saw a ball pit. Oh boy, here we go, friends. Get ready, Shark. You about to be jumped.
God,
you see, despite all the craziness of the Fazbear Fright story, they've all roughly held to the same logic. Technology infects humans, endoskeletons become
how can you make it more confusing? It's actually impossible. You can't.
Stood out. For those of you who don't remember, the title story of the very first book was Into the Pit. The story of a time-traveling ball pit that allowed a boy named Oswald to go back to the past to visit the year 1985 and see the after effects of the missing children's incident. As he does this, he's chased down by Spring Bonnie disguised as his father. It was weird, because time travel is always weird, but, you know, we didn't think too much of it at the time because it was a one-off story in a collection of random one-off stories. But now, my friends, we're coming back to it. Of all the 24 stories that Fazbear Frights has had, this is the one that the big overarching narrative of the series suddenly deems important enough to come back to for some reason. The time travel ball pit. And that's not our only clue that this thing's important. Remember Security Breach, Furry's Rage? More like MatPat's Rage at this point, because not only does the game include a dabbing Chica, but it also features a secret boss battle if you complete hard
this
mode.
This was so
a secret
funny.
Boss battle against this. A slithering reference to FNAF 4's
watching Matt
lore.
Try and solve this live on GT Live was
face,
so
FNAF
amusing.
The FNAF 4 locked box, what appears to be an IV bag in the back there. Basically, in this one sprite, we have Scott acknowledging that the real final boss of this whole damn series is figuring out what FNAF 4 was trying to tell us. It's also him poking fun
it's always been that.
Dream theory, considering the thing's name in the source code is Dreamgeist. But of all the stuff that's hidden inside of that head, there's a few random round objects that don't really fit anything from
ball
FNAF 4. Are they Easter eggs?
My God.
Maybe they're balls from a ball pit. Considering that balls and ball pits have never once been important to this series. And in the level where you fight the Dreamgeist, we see screenshots from previous games. Sister Location's blueprints, a camera feed from FNAF 1, again implying some level of time travel.
Oh
or spanning across time, because remember, Dream Theory came out before Sister Location was released, which makes that FNAF 5 blueprint reference really stand out here. Now, by no means am I saying that there's time travel in the games or anything like that, but the sudden reemergence of the ball pit in Fazbear Frights opens up
you
a
can
few
tell he's really getting into
one,
this theory.
That Cassidy died
how long
in the
has he been talking
remember,
about it?
The vengeful spirit
this
has
is only
powers
theory
that
two.
Go beyond all the other spirits, to the extent that it's able to trap Afton in a state between life and death. So if anyone or anything is gonna imbue a ball pit with time powers, Cassidy seems like the one to do it. And we know that someone did die in there because both In the Pit and the latest epilogue make a point about the pit's sticky balls. Get your mind out of the gutter there, people. Quote, he studied the plastic balls. The substance covering the plastic surface looked like blood. Old, old blood. And here I thought the worst thing that happened in a ball pit was getting pink eye. Fire up the Golden Freddy in the ball pit thumbnail, boys!
He did use Golden
Freddy. Gonna end with
so,
Larson
I mean,
Stitch
you know, check that off
the
bingo board.
To save the missing children from Afton and release their spirits. Why would I assume something like this? Well, giving Larson memory powers would be enough to tell the kid's story. Let him see glimpses of their trauma, clues that lead him on an investigation. The ball pit, though, becomes necessary if the story plans on him physically interacting with those kids. So I wouldn't be surprised if the ending of this entire book series is unwinding the thread that started.
That would be kind of cool.
Children's incident kids are saved, which in the process undoes all of the other horrific stories that spin out from the Fazbear pizzerias. In the process, Scott retroactively gives all the sad stories from the Fazbear Fright series a happy ending. And
that'd
finally,
be so
number
sweet.
Three, Detective Larson becomes Afton in what is a self-perpetuating time loop scenario.
Oh boy.
Sure. You all laugh. And
yep.
trust me,
it is game theory for
YouTuber
you.
YouTuber boxing. But hear me out here. We have ourselves a character, Larson, infected by, as the book puts it, Afton's darkness. We also have ourselves a ball pit that allows him to go back in time for some reason that's going to be important to the narrative. So what if Larson winds up going back in time to investigate only for the darkness to take over and turn him into William Afton, setting all the events of the story into motion? Who knows? Maybe we truly do exist.
I don't know how I feel about
that,
because then that's just
a loop,
allows
Afton
right?
to be a creation of his own future self. Tell you what, it would explain how Afton was able to create such futuristic advanced robotics when he was literally in the early 80s, because that's something that will never get explained. Like I said, that theory is real dumb, but you know, it is on the table.
Yeah.
I wouldn't put it past this series. Time travel opens up all sorts of
I don't know
of
how I feel about
and time loops are know. Real hot right now. And heck, we do see a lot of ball pits in that new trailer, one that comes complete with a day-night mechanic. Huh? Huh? Will I be right? Will I be wrong? We've got ourselves three more books and an indeterminate wait for security breach to
and
arrive,
more.
So you can bet the theories are just going to get more and more ridiculous until that day comes.
Like they haven't already.
Time, remember to actually listen to my dear friends Rhett and Link's new podcast.
He always debates me. I'm so ready. I don't think you guys understand. I sit through 15 minutes to say at the end of the video, but that's just a theory. A game theory, along with Matthew Patrick, and then he doesn't do it. A game theory. That wasn't that bad. I think that third theory, I'm not too big a fan of, just because it seems way too complicated. And I know the FNAF lore is complicated, but that just seems like making it unnecessarily complicated, which I'm not a huge fan of. I think those first two, however, could definitely be looked into more, especially that second one, because it seems like MatPat was super invested in that theory. Yeah, I don't know how people feel about the whole three new FNAF theory, you know, concept for this new series of FNAF game theories. I like them. I've said this in the past, and I'll keep saying it. I mean, MatPat is by far, like, probably one of, if not the most important figures in the entire FNAF community, just because it feels like he's the only one who, like, really focuses on the lore. And so being able to see, like, what's going on inside his head as he's thinking about these theories, you know, coming up with new ones, I love that. But yeah, super good episode. Again, don't know how I feel about the third one, but it was a pretty good episode. So that's gonna be it for me. Thank you everybody so much for watching this video. I do have hopefully another video going up today after this video. If it's not out tonight, I'll try and put it up before the new FNAF era skin tomorrow. It's kind of a follow-up to the Scott Cawthon drama. It involves Jonachrome and Flumpties and kind of the whole Fazbear Fanverse initiative. Oh, so yeah, stay on the lookout for that. Thank you guys so much for watching another episode of me reacting to Game Theory FNAF, and I'll see you all on the flip side. Goodbye.